Okay, good morning dear cadets. So yesterday I taught you the process of photosynthesis, okay, with the help of video, with the help of diagrams. I have explained you something. I told about the stomata also. Stomata is the very important thing. Because of stomata only gases could exchange, okay. So again I will tell you the video related with the stomata. Stomata is the small pores which is surrounded by guard cell. But before teaching the stomata, let us have idea about this particular heading, synthesis of plant food other than carbohydrate. So just see, in the photosynthesis what has happened, plants are absorbing water and carbon dioxide gas. Carbon dioxide gas from the atmosphere and water and mineral from the soil. And they are synthesizing glucose or carbohydrate or starch. That is only our food. Okay? We are taking that food from the plants. Question arises here, do the plants synthesize only carbohydrate, or other than carbohydrate they are synthesizing other food substance also, other food components also? So try to understand here, basically plants are synthesizing carbohydrate, and carbohydrate is the compound which is made up of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. This carbohydrate can be converted into some other food components also, that is called proteins and fats. Okay, so just see, this carbohydrate can be converted into proteins and fats. So as you know, proteins and fats, these are the essential component of food. They are also nutrients. So carbohydrate can only be broken into proteins and fats, remember. And carbohydrate is the energy rich component of food. We can get the energy from two particular components of food, that is the carbohydrate and fats. So carbohydrate, since can be converted into fats, so if you are taking carbohydrate, it means that only can be converted into fats. Question arises here, how the plants are converting carbohydrate into fats and protein. So what are the proteins? Proteins are nothing but a nitrogenous substance which contain nitrogen. Okay, basically protein is also made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen. But in addition to the carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, they contain trace amount of nitrogen also. That is why they are called nitrogenous compound. Actually, how the plants are synthesizing the protein, try to understand here. You might have heard about the leguminous plant. What are the leguminous plant? Tuwar, okay, soybean, peas, gram, these are called leguminous plant. If you see carefully their root, so you will find some root nodules are there, small outgrowth is there in their root. In those root nodules, some bacteria are found. These bacteria are called nitrogen fixing bacteria. What they are doing? They are absorbing the atmospheric nitrogen. You know that in atmosphere 78% nitrogen is found, and that nitrogen is free. So these bacteria, they absorb that nitrogen, and they convert this nitrogen into soluble nitrates. And those nitrates, when they are found in the root, they are fixed in the roots, they can only be converted into proteins. That is why what is told? It is told that in pulses, maximum protein is found. Soybean, that contains maximum amount of protein, because those bacteria which are found in the root nodules, they absorb the nitrogen present in the atmosphere and convert them into protein. Okay, they are called nitrogen fixing bacteria. Leguminous plant means pulse producing plant. Okay, have you got this one or not? So those bacteria, they are playing very important role for as far as the fixing of nitrogen is concerned. You know that the atmospheric nitrogen, that is inert, that is of no use. But if the same nitrogen is fixed in the form of soluble nitrates, that can be converted into proteins. And you know, to get the protein, we are taking pulses. We are eating pulses or not? So that our body should be rich with the protein. And you know, protein is a structural material. As far as the repairment of our body is concerned, protein is very important. So just what we can say, what is the conclusion of this discussion? Plants not only synthesize the carbohydrate, they synthesize the protein also. But all plants cannot synthesize the protein. Only leguminous plant, I wrote here, leguminous plant only can synthesize the protein with the help of bacteria which are found in their root nodules. Okay? So now try to understand here. Now let us wind up this discussion here. Let have some idea about this tomato. Their one animated video I will show, then you will come to know the functioning of stomata. And after completion of that one, I will teach you some other modes of nutrition. What are the other modes of nutrition? Other modes of nutrition is insectivorous mode of nutrition, saprotrophic mode of nutrition, parasitic mode of nutrition. So basically, these are the parts of heterotrophic mode of nutrition only, but I will teach you in separate heading. Okay, insectivorous, parasitic mode and saprotrophic mode of nutrition. Okay, so let us have one video. Okay, so just let us have some idea about the stomata and the functioning.
Guard cells help in opening and closing of the stomata. Let's explore more about structure and function of stomata with the help of an animation.
The carbon dioxide necessary for photosynthesis enters into the leaves through the small openings or pores present on undersurface of the leaves, known as stomata. Likewise, oxygen produced during photosynthesis diffuses out through these pores. Stomata is surrounded by many epidermal cells. Stomata have an internal opening or pore called the stoma. The stoma is flanked by two epidermal cells called as guard cells. These cells have differential thickness, that is, thin outer wall and thick inner wall facing the stoma. Each guard cell consists of a nucleus, peripherally arranged chloroplast, and a large central vacuole. The turgidity of the guard cells control the opening and closing of the stomata, which in turn regulate the loss of water from the leaves into the atmosphere. Water molecules from the surrounding epidermal cells enter into the guard cell and causes them to swell, and the stomatal pore opens up. Open stomata helps to absorb carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, which is used in the process of photosynthesis, and in return releases oxygen as a byproduct of photosynthesis. Exit of water molecules from the guard cells causes them to shrink and the stomatal pore closes. Stomata leads to loss of water, so plants close the stomata when carbon dioxide is not required for photosynthesis. Stomata even get closed during night when the process of photosynthesis stops and no gaseous exchange occurs.
So I hope that you understood the functioning of stomata. Okay? Now there are some more important point as far as the autotrophic mode of nutrition is concerned. The survival of almost all living organism directly or indirectly depends upon the food made by the plants. Okay?
Oxygen, essential for the survival of all living organisms, is produced during photosynthesis.
You know that we are not only dependent on food, on the plant, okay? We are dependent on plant for the oxygen also. And oxygen is the gas which released during the course of photosynthesis, okay?
In the absence of plants, there would be no photosynthesis and life would be impossible on Earth.
That is why the presence of plant is essential. If plants are not there, we will not have food. We will not have oxygen. Hence, our survival will be difficult. Okay? So, this is the only reason. That is why along with our presence, plant's presence is also essential. Okay? We are dependent on plants for so many things. Okay? Let us move to the another topic which
always... Synthesis of food other than carbohydrates.
Already I have explained this one.
Carbohydrates are made up of hydrogen, oxygen and carbon. Fats and proteins also contain carbon, oxygen and hydrogen. In addition to these, proteins also contain nitrogen.
Okay, there is some technical error. Now it is okay. Just see here. So already I have explained these points. Okay. Just see, carbohydrate can be converted to proteins and fats in the plants. Okay. Now let us move to the other mode of...
Let us study about other modes of nutrition.
Okay. So what are the other modes of nutrition? Just see.
Parasitic plants. Some plants which do not have chlorophyll cannot synthesize their own food material. They adopt heterotrophic mode of nutrition. In parasitic nutrition, the parasitic plant obtains its food from the other plant called host.
Okay, so in parasitic nutrition, what is happening? Parasitic plants obtain its foods from the other plant that is called host. Try to understand, parasitic mode of nutrition is also one type of heterotrophic mode of nutrition only. Only the thing is, this mode of nutrition is adopted by those plants which do not have chlorophyll. So, since they can't synthesize their food, so they will dependent on host plant to obtain their food. Okay?
Some of the parasites may harm the host plant. Parasites live in close relationship with the host. Example, Cascita. Cascita, also known as Amanita, is a plant parasite with no leaves and root. It derives its nutrition from the plant on which it thrives and is called the host plant. Complete the following sentence by choosing a correct option. Are the tiny pores which help in exchange of gases? The options are A. Guard cells, B. Stomata, or C. Chlorophyll.
What is the correct answer? Stomata. They are stomata are the tiny pores which are present on the outer surface of leaf. Okay? So answer is also here.
Insectivorous plants.
Just
some
see.
Plants are not able to get nitrogen from the soil as they grow in nitrogen deficient soil.
So just see, another heterotrophic mode of nutrition is insectivorous plants. Some plants are not able to get nitrogen from the soil. So as they grow in nitrogen deficient soil. Now just see, insectivorous plant, basically they eat insects.
These plants trap insects and digest them to get nitrogen supplement. Hence called insectivorous plants. Example, pitcher plant.
Okay, so as far as the example of insectivorous plant is concerned, that is called pitcher plant. This is the structure of pitcher plant. Okay, just see here, small hairs are there, very attractive hairs. They are called tentacles. Since they are very attractive, so because of that attractiveness, insect will be attracted toward this one. The moment they attracted here, this lid will be closed and they will be entrapped. Now those tentacles here, they will move downwards, insect will go downside and they will be digested. Okay, that is why pitcher plant is one of the best example of insectivorous plant.
Pitcher-like structure is a modified part of leaf with a lid at the apex for opening and closing of the mouth.
Okay, so just see the description of pitcher plant is given here.
Downward directed hair present in the pitcher traps the insects. Insects are digested by digestive juice secreted in the pitcher.
Okay.
Let us know little more about insectivorous plants with the help of a video.
Most plants are green in color and thus they are able to make their own food. However, some plants which are present on this earth are either non-green or grown in the soil deficient in certain nutrients, especially nitrogen. So, how do these plants obtain the nutrients they need? Such heterotrophic plants depend on green plants or on other living organisms for their nutrition. Parasitic plants like Cuscuta and Rafflesia are heterotrophic plants which absorb nutrients from another green host plant. Cuscuta is a total stem parasite as its delicate thin stem twines around the stem of the host plant. On the other hand, Rafflesia is a total root parasite and grows directly on the roots of other plants such as fig. It has the world's largest flower. According to the various modes of nutrition, another group of such heterotrophic plants is that of insectivorous plants. Insectivorous plants are green chlorophyllous plants which can make their own food like autotrophs. However, they fulfill their nitrogen requirement by trapping and digesting insects. All insectivorous plants have a specialized structure to capture insects, which is usually a modified leaf or part of a leaf. Some of the common examples of insectivorous plants are sundew, Venus flytrap, etc. The Venus flytrap leaf lamina is highly modified into two lobe-like structure. Each lobe has 15 to 20 hairs. The reddish inner surface attracts insects, and when insects come in contact with the leaf, the two lobes fold along the midrib in less than a second. The insect trapped in between the lobes gets digested and the lobes again reopen for another trap. Among the carnivorous or insectivorous plants, the most amazing are the pitcher plants. The leaf of a pitcher plant is modified into a tubular pitcher-like structure with a lid to trap the insects. The inner wall lining of the pitcher has downward pointing hairs, which do not allow any insect to climb back up and escape. The bottom of the pitcher is filled with a fluid which contains digestive juices for digesting the insects. Insects are attracted towards the pitcher by its brightly colored lid. As the insect comes near the rim of the pitcher, it slips downward and gets drowned in the fluid. The leaves of sundew have drops of sticky substance called mucilage at the end of their tentacles. Insects get stuck in this mucilage and become entangled. These helpless insects then get digested. Bladderwort are free-floating aquatic plants with leaves modified into pear-shaped bladders or sacs. The bladder has a trapdoor, which acts as a valve, and many sensitive bristles at the neck. Insects enter the bladder along with water current and get completely digested by the action of digestive juice secreted by the bladder wall. Some of the characteristics of insectivorous plants, like secretion of digestive enzymes, digestion, etc., show their close affinity with animals. However, photosynthesis and use of nitrogen bring them close to plants.
Okay, so I hope that you understood the insectivorous mode of nutrition and parasitic mode of nutrition. The best example of parasitic mode of nutrition is Cuscuta, Amar whale. You might have seen the yellow leaves plant which is climbing on other plant whose leaves are green. Since it is chlorophyll less plant, that is why it absorb or it gets the food from other plants which can synthesize their food. So now in parasitic mode of nutrition, you can explain plants cannot synthesize their own food, rather they take food from other plants. The plant from which they are getting the food, that is called host plant. Cuscuta is the best example. In the video, it has been explained properly. Insectivorous mode of nutrition, already you have seen the full video, and I hope that you can write this one. Okay. Now, there are some other questions. Name the class of plants which fix the atmospheric nitrogen, that is leguminous plant. One word answer. Name the components of food other than carbohydrate which are synthesized by plants. So, fats and proteins. Okay, what do you mean by? Already you have to explain. Give some examples of insectivorous plant. Already answer I wrote here. Pitcher plant, sundew. One more example is there which is given in the video. You can write that example also. At least two examples should be there. In this way, the duration of today's video is over. So please keep writing. Please complete the homework daily. Now, in this way only, I will complete this unit. And almost all units will be taught in the same manner. Okay? Thank you.